That's what my church wishes happens on Sunday, is that I go there and nothing works. So far, big enough mouth that they're not in luck with that. I'm Donna Boto. I get to be the senior pastor here, and it's a joy to have you all present, and it's a joy for you to get to come and hear such a wonderful enhancement to our worship. My mother was an organist growing up, so my love for this instrument exceeds what some other pastors do, because my life was spent underneath the pews listening to my mother practice. And so that was my fun. And so just seeing what this instrument does. I'm told that if you keep this, that you have recital credit. And so I'm turning mine in to get out of my newsletter article this month. Just, does that work? You don't know, okay. Thanks again for being in attendance. I want to turn over tonight to Dan Myers. We are so lucky. We are so lucky that you are here, and we're lucky for all your friendships. So.
Thank you, Donna. I started playing here in 2012 when Pastor Troy Bowers was here, and he was so supportive of music. It was just absolutely wonderful. And I thought, well, that was a once in a lifetime. That was never gonna happen again. I have to be honest, that had never happened before. So it was definitely, and then Pastor Barry came and he was the same way. And now Donna, and Donna said, well, Dan, it's the Wesley tradition. Music is so important, and we realize that. But it's just a joy to work here and to work with Pastor Donna and Pastor Courtney and to be here. I was playing for a wedding here, I think it was 6 years ago, and at the reception, one of the guests, we just happened to be sitting together, and she was organist in Texas, and she said, Dan, have you ever heard of Bradley Welch? I said, well, I've seen his name, and there are organ magazines. It probably has a pretty small readership, but I do get it, okay? It's not like any Time magazine or Sports Illustrated. In any event, she said, Dan, you have to figure out how to meet Bradley Welch. So I thought, well, I'll just look on social media. So I looked on Facebook and I found him, and he had like 3,200 friends. I thought, wow, he must be outgoing and people must really like him. So I sent Bradley a message and I said, someone we both know has suggested I come meet you in Dallas. I would love to have an organ lesson with you. And he responded, and I flew down there, and we agreed to a 2-hour lesson, and 3 hours into it, I mean, I couldn't go any longer, but it was really one of the musical highlights of my life. So we became friends. Bradley was here last year and played at K-State. Bradley's from Knoxville, Tennessee. He was trying to decide between being an eye doctor or a concert organist when he was in high school. And so he went to Baylor University because they had strong programs in both of those fields. And he just was such an exceptional student. He ended up going to Yale University. And you know, I've been the grad school route myself. I didn't realize you could get 4 graduate degrees from an institution, but he has 4 different music graduate degrees, including a doctoral degree from Yale University. One of the degrees was a performance certificate, so where you spend a whole year just concentrating on being a performer. So he's in great demand. He has been someplace different every weekend, just for weeks and weeks and weeks, playing totally different programs. From here, he's going to Lake City, Iowa, to play at the Dobson Organ Company this weekend for their 50th anniversary, and he's playing a totally different program than what he's playing tonight. So anyway, it's just a great joy to have Bradley. So without any further ado, this is Dr. Bradley Hunter Welch.
Thank you. Thank you so much. It's such a pleasure to be back in the Little Apple in Manhattan, Kansas. Having been here just about a year ago, it was wonderful to get to know the great instrument at K-State, and Dan Myers had said, I really want to have you back to play on the organ at First Methodist and celebrate a little bit some of the new stops that have been added. So I knew that I had to come up with some different music to play than what I played a year ago. So that opening toccata by Robert Hebbel, I think captures the joy of the blessings that flow from God, and we give thanks for those, of which this organ is one. Next, I'd like to take us on a tour of as many colors of the instrument as I can cram into about 8 minutes' time through this little set of variations on a Christmas tune, O Laufet ihr Hirten. It's a Lutheran Christmas carol translated roughly as, O Run, You Shepherds. You know, since Walmart has already started getting out the Christmas decorations, we might as well join in the fun. So there are a total of 9 variations, and the tune begs for all sorts of coloristic treatments. Drishner gives no suggestions about what kinds of sound I should use. And I love pieces like that because I can then customize it to whatever instrument that I'm playing. So we'll hear a tour of lots of beautiful flutes and strings and reed colors, all culminating in a rollicking shepherd's dance at the end. Then after that, I'll play a wonderful work by Johann Sebastian Bach. It's said that no organ recital is complete without a work by Bach. And the D major is one of my favorites because of its youthful energy and great contrasts. As soon as the piece begins with kind of D major fanfares and flourishes, the mood shifts to something dark and angular. But then as soon as that happens, then we shift back to D major. So you'll hear this back and forth of style in the prelude, and the prelude ends with a slow grave with very dissonant chords, dissonant for Bach's time, leading us through a kind of harmonic thorn bush until gradually landing back at D major, which sets us up for one of the most joyous fugues in all of Bach's output. So, 2 pieces quite contrasting, both by German composers. The variations on O Run, You Shepherds by Max Drishner, and then the prelude and fugue in D major of Johann Sebastian Bach. Thank you. So one of the exciting additions to this instrument is hard to miss, these wonderful trumpets in the front, trumpet en chamade. And interestingly, I have to brag on my state of residence right now. The first trumpet en chamade in this country was installed at First Presbyterian Church in Kilgore, Texas. And it's quite a Spanish-influenced stop. Usually the tone can be very, very bright and piercing. I have to say this is one of the most beautiful of this kind of trumpet en chamade that I've ever heard. It's warm, it's round, it's still exciting, and has a nice point to the sound, but it's not overbearing. And I'm playing it at close range, so it's quite wonderful to encounter a stop like this. And so that led me to program the next piece, Heraldings, by Robert Hebbel, the same composer who wrote the toccata on the doxology with which we opened the program. Robert Hebbel was commissioned to write this piece for the inauguration of the great Hazel Wright organ at the former Crystal Cathedral in Garden Grove, California, now Christ Cathedral, a Catholic cathedral. That organ is spectacular because of its size and because of the way that it's laid out within the cathedral. The main organ is in the front. There's a very substantial back organ that's probably about the size of this entire instrument. And then in the east and west corners of the cathedral, there are chamade trumpets. So there is organ literally surrounding you from all four corners of the earth. And Robert Hebbel makes great use of that in wonderful dialogues and exciting trumpet fanfares. We don't have surround sound here per se, but this instrument, I think, holds its own very well in bringing this piece off. You'll notice a definite jazz influence in some of the harmonies, and definitely in this kind of jazzy, rhythmic, dancing middle section that you'll hear. And gradually from out of the middle section, it gets ramped back up into some of the opening material. So I hope you enjoy Heraldings by Robert Hebbel.
Thank you.
Aren't these trumpets nice? If they're missing, don't come looking for them in Dallas. So now something to contrast and calm. I'd like to play the Andante Sostenuto from Charles-Marie Vidor's Gothic Symphony. Vidor wrote a total of 10 symphonies for organ, which they're symphonies more likely in the sense that they capitalize on the symphonic capabilities of the instrument that he played at Saint-Sulpice in Paris. These pieces are really wonderful and monuments of the French organ literature. This particular one is, I think, a little jewel. Reminds me very much of Claude Debussy's Clair de Lune. There's no fancy footwork in this, so it's a wonderful kind of suspended in mid-air, beautiful just meditation. It uses in the outer sections some of the beautiful harmonic flute sounds of the instrument. And in the middle, all of the 8-foot foundations kind of wrap around us with a nice warm hug. I feel like this instrument does this piece so well and so evocatively that I am very happy that I programmed it. If you'll hold your applause at the end of that, then we'll go right into a set of 3 pieces by Frederick Swan. Fred Swan was the organist at the Crystal Cathedral for many years. It was a huge inspiration to me when I would videotape the Hour of Power on Sunday mornings and then go back and watch to see what Fred did in his hymn playing and his conducting and playing for the choir. I had the great honor of being the festival organist this past January at the former Crystal Cathedral, playing the Hazel Wright organ in a festival honoring the life and musical legacy of Dr. Frederick Swan. And so it was a joy to be part of that. And I played the 3 pieces that you'll hear here, his trumpet tune, and then his arrangement of Amazing Grace, and then finally, Great is Thy Faithfulness. So I hope you enjoy first this Vidor, and then after that, 3 pieces by Frederick Swan.
Thank you.
Next, I'd like to play for you a piece that really is unique in the organ world. Virgil Fox was one of the greatest organists who ever lived, and he was invited to play for a national convention of the American Guild of Organists in Philadelphia on the largest pipe organ in the world, which is at the Wanamaker department store, now a Macy's. I always say it's kind of a monument to capitalism that the world's largest pipe organ is in a department store. So Virgil was invited to play, and he decided he wanted to play something by Bach, and was inspired by Leopold Stokowski's orchestration for the Philadelphia Orchestra of the Bach chorale, Komm süßer Tod, Come Sweetest Death. And Virgil arranged this in two verses, making use of the massive string complement of this organ, string pipes that imitate the sounds of violins, violas, and cellos in a way that's quite remarkable. And in these two verses, the first verse never gets very loud. The second verse builds all the way up to full organ and gradually dies away, much like dying away into darkness, that final darkness before the never-ending dawn. So there's nothing to watch as I play this piece, so I invite you to just close your eyes and let the sound wash over you and enter into the mystery of music and how, with no words, Bach can paint a picture. Come, sweetest death, come, blessed rest. Take my hand and gently lead me on.
Thank you.
So now comes the seventh inning stretch when we get some audience participation. So I'd like for us to sing one of my favorite hymns as a kind of prelude to the piece that will end the program. So if you'll grab the hymnal out of the pew rack in front of you, number 139, Praise to the Lord the Almighty. There's a story behind this piece. So Aaron David Miller is an incredible organist, church musician, composer, who's at House of Hope Presbyterian in St. Paul, Minnesota. And Aaron came to Dallas in early 2010 to play a recital on a new Dobson pipe organ that was installed at the church where I served, Highland Park United Methodist. And Aaron opened the program with one of his own compositions and then was planning to close the program with an improvised four-movement symphony based on themes that the audience would write down and give to him. I always am amazed by people who can do that, but I'm a little suspicious that they're somehow downloading my social security number and bank accounts while I'm talking to them. So in any case, Aaron played a brilliant first half, really wonderful. And an elder statesman of our choir came over to me and said, how do you like his music? And I said, I love it, it's just wonderful. And he said, would you ever like him to write a piece for you? And I said, possibly. Let me look at kind of some of his compositions to get an idea of his style. And if we're thinking of commissioning something, let me see maybe him or maybe another composer, because I didn't really know his work that well. So my friend nodded and went back to his seat. We heard a brilliant second half, four-movement improvised symphony, just mind-blowing complexity and enjoyment. And so then my friend Roy came back over and said, well, my wife's over there writing the check for your new piece. And so I said, oh, okay, so I guess we are commissioning something from Aaron. So I made my way over to Roy's wife, Sue, who was pulling the check out of her checkbook. And I said to Dr. Miller, well, it sounds like you're writing a piece for me. And he said, yeah, I guess so. And I said, well, how much of a piece will that check buy me? And he looked at it and his eyes kind of lit up and he said, oh, I'd say about 10 or 12 minutes worth. So we talked a little bit about basing it on a favorite hymn. We landed on Praise to the Lord the Almighty. And I said, it really, if you could just take the ideas from your four-movement symphony, this kind of really exciting opening, then an angular, irregular meter scherzo section in kind of minor mode, and then a really colorful, harmonically adventurous aria that would show off lots of colors of the organ, and then maybe end with a roaring toccata, just kind of like you just did. And then Sue, the lady who wrote the check, said, oh, and you must write a treacherously difficult pedal cadenza for Dr. Welch. So we had essentially written the piece for him right there with all of our ideas, and he just had to go back to Minnesota and put it in his computer. And about 2 months later, the piece arrived, and you never know what you're going to get. I mean, even more so than, you know, buying something off of Amazon, you really don't know what you're going to get when you commission a piece from even a composer you love. I was so happy with this, and it has really proved its worth over the past 14 years. People really enjoy it. So what we're going to do first is sing this hymn on which it's based. If you'll notice the instructions in your program, all sing verse 1, sing in harmony on 2, then men sing verse 3, and then trebles. Some people don't know what trebles mean. Women and children into the lifeboats, sing verse 4, and then there will be an interlude, and then we'll sing verse 5 all together once again in unison. So if you'll stand and raise your voices together.